I don't want to repeat what last speakers usually say in conferences and congress, but it's obvious that everybody, including myself, is tired. I'm gonna speak as much as briefly as I can. My talk will be given under the capacity of a political sociologist rather than of a political theorist who is dealing recently with a newly emerged subfield which may called political sociology of emotions. My talk has five parts. Don't get worried. I will be brief, as I said. First part has to do with the politics emotion nexus. Then a terminological comment. The third part has to do with the analysis of populism alongside emotional terms and alongside the political sociology of emotion. Then the fourth part will focus on a special issue which has to do with the role of resentment in populist discourse and practice. And finally, I will conclude with some recommendations and comments concerning theoretical, conceptual, and methodological applications which may come out of this interdisciplinary, actually, endeavor. So, as starting with the politics emotion nexus, for many decades, scholarly, academic, mainstream political analysis was almost stripped from any reference to emotions. And in that sense, one could very well spot an emotions-proof period of political sociological research. That is to say, political scientists and sociologists were refrained of getting into the analysis of emotion because, first, they were somehow afraid of bringing the irrationality, the irrational, into the so-called high politics. Then there are three other additional reasons which made for this reluctance. One of them is that ever since the end of the 17th century, with the advent, that is to say, of modernity, there has been a replacement of passion by interest. Interest as a dimension of the rationality of the autonomous actor. Another scholarly reason which explains this reluctance is the, for the many years, dominance of the rational choice paradigm, the rational choice theory school, in very many political science and sociology, but mostly political science departments, at both sides of the Atlantic, where analysts of this sort were really hostile against emotions, although quite recently, that is to say, during the last at least 10 years, some of them have started taking seriously emotions into account, even though emotions for them is one of the many traits that a rational actor may take into account in order to rationally act in public sphere. And a third epistemic reason was that usually, whenever emotions were somehow, or the affective side was somehow taken into account, most of the time people used over sweeping categories. An example for this is that, for instance, in the political culture research tradition, Almond and Verba, that is to say, people were used to speak about affective orientations alongside cognitive orientations and evaluative orientations which make for each particular political culture. And when the discussion was coming to the affective orientations, there was no any deep going analysis. At the very same period, the Michigan School, the notorious research done by Campbell and his associates, used the V grant category in electoral sociology, that is to say, party identification. Okay, what is exactly party identification? There may be different emotional reactions within this sweeping category. Loyalty, for instance, trust, familiarity, and so on and so forth. So, on the one hand, in the rational choice tradition, emotions and affectivity was exercised altogether for many years. On the other hand, at the cultural, on the political cultural tradition, emotions were hidden, so to say, within overgeneralized categories. In the meantime, of course, and we've been discussing about it over the 2 days now, an emotional or affective turn has taken place, which has an impact on almost every single field and subfield of social science and humanities. Of course, this impact is not equal in every particular subdiscipline, but it is quite obvious everywhere, almost everywhere. First time in my life I'm using this thing for getting. yes. One of the consequences of this affective turn in the study of politics is that a growing number of political sociologists and political scientists have started looking at politics at a different way. They, in a sense, then they are bringing emotions back into the political and sociological analysis. In a way, I would say that this bringing emotions back into the analysis is may be resembled as the return of the repressed, so to say. Emotions have been repressed for many decades. Now they come back again. I mean, and this is important, if not anything else, because every single political philosopher from the ancient Greek onwards was at the same time a philosopher or a psychologist of emotions. Take, for instance, Plato, take for instance, Aristotle, take, for instance, Spinoza, Adam Smith, Machiavelli, and so many others. Hobbes, if one, for instance, wants to start dealing and studying fear or terror, one should at least start with Hobbes. Uh, It is not, but it is not only the philosophers, the political philosophers who have taken emotions very seriously. Marx himself had emotions in mind. Gramsci himself has taken emotions quite seriously, for instance, when he was speaking about the moment of enthusiasm, when the revolution will come. Tocqueville was at pains to analyze the newly established American democracy alongside some very strong emotions, for instance, envy, where he makes very, very succinct observations and remarks. Let me also remind you of Benedict Anderson's imagined notion of the nation as an imagined community, which is, quotation, based on profound emotional legitimacy. So the ground is here. And this ground has to do with a new understanding, to be more precise, it has to do with a newly emerging understanding of the politics emotions nexus. And this ground will help us later on to see how the analysis of populism may gain some extra points out of this. But before going into this analysis, let me refer to a crucial and pertinent and sometimes poignant problem with regards to the political sociology of emotions and the sociology of emotions for that matter, but also to the psychology of emotions and almost any kind of scientific approach, systematic approach to emotion. And this has to do with the terminology. Like it or not, willy-nilly, we are somehow lost in translation because ever since 1884, when William James, the founder of the modern science of psychology, published a notorious article titled "What is an Emotion?" Ever since, scholars from different disciplines have been trying to define emotion or to define affect, and I can tell you that there is a labyrinth, a terminological labyrinth, not only between disciplines. And I say so because we are dealing with interdisciplinarity right now, but also within each discipline itself. For instance, in 1881, a well-known article in psychological article appeared, where the authors pointed into, if I remember well, 91 different definitions and conceptualization of emotions within psychology. Then they clustered them into seven different categories and so on and so forth. Sometimes, some sociologists, because of this terminological elusiveness, refrain from giving any specific definition of what is an emotion, or they may use emotion, affect, sentiment, feeling in an interchangeable way. Some of the criteria they use, for instance, is time. Most of the psychologists of emotion would say an emotion is a flash affective reaction to an external stimuli. Whereas sentiment or affect is something more lasting and more grounded and more cognitively elaborated. And as sociologists, political sociologists, we might think, shall we take this notion into account in our own analysis? Do flash, so to say, emotions have to do with political analysis? Yes, they have. For instance, in cases of political rituals, demonstrations, rebellions, and so on and so forth. But is this the only category of emotions? Not, of course. We should strive for more lasting emotions, more programmatic and relational emotions, or sentiments in that sense, like trust, like cynicism, like gratitude, like loyalty, and so on and so forth. On top of this terminological elusiveness, slippery, so to say, there is a host of different typologies, which sometimes makes our life difficult. Listen to some of them. Primary, mixed, self-targeted versus other-targeted, introjected versus extrojected, self-asserting, self-transcending, relational, iterated, programmatic, biological, social, moral, negative, positive, lasting, transient, sanctioning, structural, anticipatory. All these are typologies of emotions. One sociologist of emotions, he's called Tam, if I pronounce well his name, admiring the chemists, he moved forward and constructed a periodical table of emotions according to some structural features, which is quite impressive, I can tell you, quite difficult to follow, but he moved up to that point because he wanted to organize this slippery field. It seems, though, that before getting that, as I said before, many times, very often, sociologists use these terms, these emotion terms, interchangeably. Sometimes I do it myself. Sometimes I don't do it. Sometimes I'm using sentiments in order to refer to lasting and programmatic and relational affective states. Some other times I use emotion or feeling. But I don't want to get into more details on that. Very many sociologists, however, would agree, based on mainly on Serer, a psychologist of emotions, would agree over a component architecture of emotion. That is to say that emotion is something, let's not define it, it's something which has some components. And these components are at least five. First, activation of the entire self and the body, activation and action readiness. Emotion is always emotion, a movement towards something. One would say, for instance, that emotion is an instantiation of the will or of the drives. Then you have to have an appraisal. So psychologists have put much effort to understand and measure the process of appraisal. What is exactly an appraisal? And then you may have automatic appraisals and more elaborate appraisals. But whenever, in one way or another, there is always some sort of cognitive appraisal of a situation, of an object or a subject. an external stimulus, that is to say. Then, expression. Emotions are both basic emotions, primary emotions, and secondary, more mixed and complex emotions are always expressed. Expressed through facial expressions, expressed through paralinguistic gestures, through body language, and so on. Fourth, and here is where sociology comes, cultural linguistic labels. You know very well that different cultures have different, sometimes have different names, different linguistic labels, different linguistic tags for the same emotions or for different emotions. Sometimes there are so much culture-specific emotions which are untranslatable to any other language, totally untranslatable. And sociologists and linguists have been trying for so long now to make a dictionary of emotive terms so as to understand how, for instance, love can have different linguistic and conceptual shades in different cultures. Cultural linguistic labels then, and fourth, rules of experience and expression, that is to say, cultural emotional rules, which have to do with norms which are of course historically constructed, norms which imply how, when, and where people are entitled or permitted to express their emotions and to experience particular emotions. Of course, one should not expect all these five elements or these five components of the emotional experience to be present in every single instance of emotional reaction or emotional act. Nor is it necessary for someone while he is experiencing an emotion to experience it consciously. Most of the time we have emotions which remain at the subliminal level of consciousness, below the threshold of consciousness, that is to say. In one way or another, because of this complexity, there are certain scholars who said that emotion is a multi-component phenomenon or an open affective system. A possible way out of this labyrinth, conceptual labyrinth, possibly, this is what I usually do, but I don't pass it as a one-size-for-all recipe, is to preserve the generic notion, emotion in the singular, which accommodates different emotive experiences, such as feelings, affect, sentiment, passion, and so on. How much time do I have? 20 more minutes. Excellent. So let's get then to the third part of the presentation, which is how we can emotionally analyze populism. Populism can be studied this has been repeatedly said in this conference, as a political discourse, as an ideology. Personally, I doubt that it is an ideology, but anyhow, there are people who say so. As a movement, as a regime, as a political practice, as a code, as a style, as a political style, or as a syndrome, or as an element of political culture. What is more, we all know that populism can be, it should be actually analyzed in conjunction with other ideological discourses or ideologies, such as patriotism, nationalism, racism, fascism, and so on. Nearly all interpretations of populism include an affective or the affective factor. Take, for instance, the well-known reference to the charismatic leadership as an ingredient. Some scholars of populism say think that this is a necessary condition in order to have populism. So, what is charismatic leadership if not a relation where much emotional energy takes place and it is exchanged? Yet, and this goes back to what I was saying about the political analysis, the analysis of politics stripped from the emotional aspect. Yet then, the affective dimension in populism has been studied most of the time, for most of the scholars, in a disguised or an implicit way. More attention was given to discursive or organizational aspects. Speaking about the discursive aspects, this emotional turn I refer to somehow succeeds the linguistic turn in late 70s, early 80s. Of course, I don't mean that the linguistic, that is to say, discursive approaches are to be withered away, no. But the emotional turn can be very well articulated in our analysis with the linguistic one so as to have better and more meaningful understandings of political phenomena and of populism for that matter. So, often then, in the analysis of populism, emotions or feelings or sentiments or whatever, choose whatever terminology you want, were used in a metonymic way. That is, the analysis of each particular populism has been carried out through the use of general affective categories and not through the interpretation and the analysis of concrete emotions. One of the gains we've got out of the emotive turn is that we focus at particular emotions, distinct emotions, and this is something I think that we should keep in mind as a orientational, so to say, as an orientational course towards the analysis of any single political phenomenon. Then, that these oversweeping and general categories, the metonymic, that is to say, way of dealing with the affective dimension of populism, was expressed with over generalities like passion, affect, even jouissance. For example, let's take some examples. It has been argued that the discontent of the agricultural and lower middle classes, caused by the enforcement of economic policies, and the institutions of the political system fueled an antipathy and caused an alienation which was felt against the power elites as far as the American populism or the kind of populism is concerned in Latin American North American. But let me have some reservations about these categories. Discontent, alienation, antipathy. We may very well use them, but believe me, behind and below these categories, if someone wants to scratch a bit, one is likely to find an array of positive and negative emotions, which, as soon as they are presented, they may reveal a more rich and more informative landscape. For instance, sentiments or feelings of sorrow, of hatred, of rage, of indignation, of envy, and so on. In the interpretation of, you know it very well, of the Russian populism, this romantic idealization of the agricultural community and this myth of the people is regarded to be two of the most powerful mechanisms for carry on the populist discourse. Yes, that's true. But behind these general mechanisms, socio-psychological mechanisms, mythologization, idealization, there is a raw material, a much fresh raw material, joy, hope, nostalgia, admiration, pride, exaltation, and so on. Sometimes, apart from this metonymic treatment of the emotive aspect of populism, other scholars, I have in mind, for instance, Taggart, use some terms which are not quite the proper ones. Taggart's heartland, as the mythical one, the mythical Taggart heartland. For him, it's a necessary constitutive element of populism. Again, Canovan's populist mood. She regards it to be the fundamental element of populist movement, which is based on a heightened enthusiasm for charismatic leaders. It's based and expressed through spontaneity of the people, the multitude, I was inclined to say. And which is, for her, Canovan, populism is can serve as a sort of redemptive politics. That is to say, one can have a healthy democratic, Yanis would say, healthy populism in order to save democracy and politics itself. As I said before yesterday, even Chantal Mouffe, she uses herself the category of passion as an encompassing category which may hide, accommodate, or disguise a different emotional, positive and negative emotional reactions. The particular interest, the special interest one has to to give to the analysis of discrete and particular emotions in each particular case of populism is crucial, because if not anything else, let me refer to Kenneth Minogue, who as early as 69, he said, to understand the populist movement is to discover the feelings, he used the word feelings which moved people. In a nutshell, I would say that there is not one, but many, although interrelated emotions and feelings that make possible populism as a practice, as a movement, as a discourse, or as a regime, or as a style of political action to be given rise to. In the context of particular populisms, which are screened out from particular and historically concrete political cultures, of course, one can easily find a wide range of feelings, which include, as I said before, nostalgia, angst, anxiety, helplessness, hatred, vindictiveness, ecstasy, melancholy, anger, fear, indignation, envy, spite, resentment, and so on and so forth. And with this last word, resentment, I'm coming to the third or fourth part of my talk. In order to interpret the American political scene of the 50s, Edward Sills, in 1956, defined populism as an ideology of resentment against the social establishment imposed by the long-term domination of a class which is considered to have the monopoly of power, property, and civilization. So in his account, resentment is a sort of moral indignation, of moral anger. And of course, he is not the only one who understands resentment in this way. In the long-standing discussion about resentment, one can ascertain two different traditions. The non-Nietzschean tradition, which is designated linguistically with resentment, and the Nietzschean account, the Nietzschean tradition, which is linguistically designated with the French technicus terminus, resentiment. Both emotions are negative and unpleasant emotions. Anyhow, but there are differences. Some differences which sometimes make a difference in the analysis of particular populisms. So those adhering to the Nietzschean view of resentiment deem it as a morality of the weak creatures who, quotations, have been forbidden of the real reaction of the act. This is from the Genealogy of Morals, Nietzsche. In Nietzsche's mind, in Nietzsche's thought, the resentful man, forgive me for this gender offensive expression, but I'm using his own words, or at least the resentful person, is governed by a frightened baseness that appears as humility. His submission to those he hates becomes docility. His weakness is supposedly transformed into patience or even virtue. So the basic characteristic of Nietzsche's resentful person, resentful man, is a vindictiveness in disguise, a disguised vindictiveness, which leads to inaction, to non-action, that is to say. One of the greatest representatives of this tradition, and by whom I was very much influenced, while once upon a time I was staying in Essex, is of course Max Scheler, Max Scheler's analysis of resentment. According to Scheler, there are a number of necessary and sufficient conditions in order to formulate, to be experienced. First, as I said before, a non-acted out vindictiveness. You feel offended, you feel injured, you feel that your sense of justice was violated by some wrongdoing, but yet you are unable to do something about it. You are unable to do something about it because you are powerless. Powerless, either due to a physical handicap, or the likelihood is that more often is the case, or due to some social inferiority. This analysis of powerlessness as a necessary condition for resentment to be experienced refers us quite clearly to that complex but very useful discussion about political alienation and powerlessness as a dimension of political alienation, which was carried out ever since mid-50s in the American political science. Beyond these two necessary conditions, Scheler descends some sufficient conditions as well. And these are, first, the discrepancy, a gap, that is to say, between the formally entitled rights one has in contemporary society and the reality of actualizing them. Just let me remind you that one of the most succinct descriptions of anomie by Merton, for instance, or by Seaman, or other political social psychologists in the 60s and the 70s, was this discrepancy between the goals put forward by the society itself and the lack of means for the individual to implement, to accomplish these goals. Comparison, social comparison. You cannot feel envy, you cannot feel resentful, you cannot hate, you cannot feel anger unless you compare yourself with others. This is an important point, and keep it in mind because at the end, at the last part of my presentation, I will refer back to it. Social comparison in terms, for instance, of power, of social status, of money, of social capital, and so on and so forth. You know very well, for instance, that consumerism as a practice and as a soft ideology, which promises a false equity between everyone, and be, on the basis of the on the basis of an internal and perpetuated μετατόπιση, disposition, displacement, yeah, displacement of the object of desires, is the socio-cultural environment where resentment may flourish in our societies. Irrevocable injustice. It is not enough for someone to feel that it is morally injured by someone, the someone being the state, the another person, an institution or whatever, another state or whatever. This is not enough. One has to internalize the fact that this injustice is something irrevocable, is somehow his or her destiny, is something which cannot be overcome. Finally, and this is a subtle and crucial aspect of the Max Eller's account of resentment, the resentful person transforms the values which at the first place estimates, but because of his vindictiveness, because of his inferiority, chronic inferiority, because of his rumification of the, because of the internal rumification of his or her interiority, at the end of the day, out of a syndrome of reaction formation, he transforms these values, and then what he unconsciously admires, he or she unconsciously admires, at the level of the conscience, he or she denies it. Take, for instance, the case of the people. Imagine someone who, a petty bourgeois or a small merchant, who admires very much the bourgeoisie or even the aristocracy. He would very much want to be like them, but because it's impossible, it is his or her destiny not ever to become like them. So he denies, he transforms what he at the first hand admires and wishes, and transforms it through a process of self-pity and self-hatred, and then instead of admiring, instead of wanting to become an aristocrat or a bourgeois, he exalts the man of the street, he exalts the people. So this reaction formation, which is actually what transvaluation is about, most of the time, in terms of individual psychology, makes for this mythologization of the people. It's the very psychological mechanism, how the people becomes a sacred symbol. If I was to give you an definition of resentment, and I want to say one more time that resentment is a technicus terminus in the relevant literature, I would say that it is an unpleasant moral sentiment without specific addresses, which operates as a chronic relieving of repressed and endless vindictiveness, hostility, envy, and indignation due to the impotence of the subject in expressing them, resulting at the level of values in the negation of what he unconsciously desires. Maybe maybe instead of negation, I would use disavowal. This is a matter of interpretation. In his attempt to explain the emergence of the extreme right European populist parties, Hans-Georg Betsch, I think you referred to him earlier this afternoon, uses the concept of resentment. He states particularly that in the early phase of their appearances, parties were greatly buttressed, supported by the diffused grievances of working and lower middle class electorate against, of course, globalization, the immigrants, the fiscal crisis of the welfare state, the politicians' corruption, and so on and so forth. Thus, he says, these parties can be seen as a result of, quotation, resentments. But he uses the French term, resentiment, in plural. I think that, of course, Betsch is an authority in this, in the analysis of extreme right, radical right, populist movements and parties, but I think that he misses something. And he misses something because in his analysis he oscillates between the Nietzschean and the non-Nietzschean understanding of resentment. Definitely, I would say, resentiment in the Sellerian sense, according to this definition, does not lead to mobilization. Because, as I explained before, resentiment leads to inaction. He makes the subject passive, anyway. It is resentment in the non-Nietzschean sense, that is to say, resentment qua moral indignation, moral anger, which may lead to action and political mobilization and populist mobilization for that matter. So therefore, contrary to Betsch, I maintain that resentiment can be used not for the interpretation of the first phase of the appearance of the of those parties, but it can be used as an emotive term which designates, of course, an entire emotional energy and emotional dynamics, which serves as which offers an environment for the incubation, for the preparation, the incubation of these parties and these extreme right movements. That is to say, I would differentiate three phases. First phase, as I said, is this preparatory phase of incubation. Second, the initial phase of the appearance of these parties where resentment in the non-Nietzschean sense is put into effect. And third, the phase of the success or failure of these parties, which is not determined anymore by the emotional energy of the two previous phases, but mostly depends on the dynamics of the political and the political system and the dynamics of the party system as well. Pierre André Daguieff, I think that everybody knows this name with regards to the analysis of the same kind of phenomena. He has also paid considerable attention to resentment. as a constituting element of populism and racism and ethno-nationalism or nationalism populism, as he calls it, in contemporary European societies. But again, because he does not theorize, he does not problematize theoretically the term, sometimes, like Betz, he oscillates between the Nietzschean and the non-Nietzschean tradition of resentment. Let me point at this moment that distinguish resentment from resentment, as I think I mentioned it before, is not a pedantic or a scholastic issue. It's, I think, it is a crucial key point in order to understand and describe different aspects of a seemingly uniform political phenomena, but just seemingly uniform political phenomena. An example of this failure to differentiate between the different conceptualizations of resentment is that the translator of Marc Ferro's Le Resentiment dans l'Histoire, I don't know if I pronounced it well, the translator translated Ferro's resentiment into the English word resentment. And believe me, when I went through the book, I couldn't really understand what the argument was about. While, for instance, Ferro refers to the resentment of Christians against the Jews, or other social categories against others. Also, another indication of this conflating of the two terms is the translation of Svetan Todorov's La peur des barbares ou le de la du choc des civilisations, where his countries of resentment, as primary against the countries of fear, as he wants to call them, is converted into countries of resentment. In an analysis of the Greek populism I attempted some years ago, this distinction was put into effect. I don't have time to get into much details on this, but let me just sketch the argument a bit, yes. As it has been repeatedly stated in this room, we refer to the Greek national, the Greek populism, with main reference to PASOK, the notorious decade of populism, the 80s. So the rise of PASOK, the Greek socialist, was buttressed, if not driven, by a plurality of emotions typical of populations which are undergoing rapid social upward mobility. And these emotions are repressed vindictiveness, vengeance, spite, envy, and of course, resentment. We know that PASOK was heavily supported by the new middle strata which came out of the defeat of the Civil War. These social strata, social layers, have been more or less integrated into the economic and social system. Ideologically, especially through consumerism, but through the early emerging consumerism of the 60s and the 70s, But because of the repercussions of the civil war, they were politically marginalized. In the 60s then, when the expectations were raised, the expectations, that is to say, of being included in the political system, most of the time, the members of this social strata cultivated a sense of resentment, that is, of moral indignation. Why should we be second-class citizens? We have to become recognized as first-class citizens. Because in the first place, we are very well integrated into the capitalist market, so to say. But then we had the 7-year dictatorship. That period was a period where the inferior sociopolitical position of the members of this middle class strata was experienced not only as a second trauma. The first trauma was the defeat in the civil war. The second trauma now was the disillusionment of any democratic way out, but also they internalized it as a sense of an injustice which cannot be removed, of an unbearable injustice. And because of that, I remind you that this irrevocable sense of injustice is one of the sufficient conditions for seller in order resentment to put forth. And because of this irrevocable injustice, these people started feeling a deep resentment. A deep resentment. But as soon as the socialist took the lead, took the office, this resentment was released and get transformed into either to vindictiveness or to public vindictiveness or to a revenge. I remind you, I don't know if you remember that, because your age is, we have some decades of difference here, but I remind you of the Tus Prasinofrurus, the Green Guards of PASOK. So what I tried to do in that piece of work was to demonstrate that emotions, and in our case, resentment and resentment, just because I wanted to isolate these two emotions, of course, as I said, there is a huge array, a range of other emotions, are contingent upon structural factors. You may have an emotion which is a reaction to a given situation, the appraisal of a given situation, as I said before. As soon as the political opportunity structures changes, as was the case with the PASOK government, resentment was transformed into other sort of active emotion. I'm sure that some questions will be raised on that, so I will have the opportunity to respond to this. So let me now come to the final part of my talk, which has to do with theoretical, conceptual, and methodological repercussions of bringing emotions back into political analysis and to the analysis of populism, for that matter. In order then to avoid overgeneralizations or to avoid superficial analysis or superficial understandings of the emotive dimension of populism, it seems to me that it is necessary to find specifiable, that is to say, very concrete and appropriate theories of emotions for different levels of analysis of populism. For instance, there is the interactional ritual theories, not theory, theories, which originate from Durkheim's analysis in the elementary forms of the religious life, where he speaks about emotion, about the effervescence in rituals, in religious rituals, etc. This tradition was taken up by Randan Collins, which is a very strong figure in this area, and all, as well by Erica Summers Effler and some others, who very analytically and explicitly using mostly qualitative methods, they are in a position to specify specific emotions which are elicited in different rituals. And in populism, you can very easily can understand that we have plenty of rituals, demonstrations, gatherings, electoral campaigns, and so on and so forth. So one should, within the discursive context of populism, one and the context of populist practices, one could very well use this theory in order to focus on these things, particularly. Then, something which is that I am much more keen: structural theories of emotions. Remember when I said before that social comparison is one of the sufficient conditions for Seller to have his intima. So there have been scholars like Kemper, like Thum, like Berger, like Selig, and many others, who take into account some basic basic dimensions of social life, such as power, status, and blame attribution, may formulate a structural scheme which says, for instance, when someone has, according to his own social position, I mean, and according to his own expectations, another crucial dimension in these theories, according to his expectations and according to his social positions, he may enjoy a certain amount of power and status. And if the expectations are the appropriate one, according to his social position, he feels satisfaction. He feels maybe joy. He feels relaxed. But if there is a difference in the dynamics of structure and status, sorry, of power and status, that is to say, if he is deprived, for instance, for many very different reasons, deprived of social recognition, he may feel disappointed. Or if he is deprived of power, because, for instance, he or she is experiencing a very dramatic deficit in his family budget, he or she may feel feared. Then again, add to these three things, power, status, and expectations, add the fourth one, which is the blame attribution. Whenever one thinks that one is to blame oneself for the loss of power or the loss of status, he may feel shame, he may feel guilty, but if the attribution of blame, the blame attribution is put on the, is extroverted, is put to somebody else, the establishment, the Americans, the government, whatever, he may feel rage, he may feel morally ignited, he may experience different sorts of experience. Second, we should, I think, we precisely because we are trying to circumscribe, so to say, circulate the phenomenon of populism from different perspectives and from different disciplines, I think that we should use sound and solid quantitative and qualitative methodologies so as to triangulate our research results. And this can be done, of course, in the appropriate way according to the different level of analysis and according to the different subject matter at hand each time. And last but not least, as I repeatedly said before, we should strive for analyzing clear and distinct emotion terms. And this thing is not very easy, because in the relevant literature there has been a growing discussion about, for instance, the difference between shared and common emotions. They are not the same. So, or about self-targeted or other targeted emotions according to the typologies I referred to before. So the literature from the sociology of emotions, from the neuroscience of emotions, from the psychology of emotions are replete of such problematics, and I think that only gains can get the analysis of populism if it is to expose itself into these more recent developments in these fields. So by all this being said, I finalize my talk. Thank you very much for your attention, and I will very much want to discuss with you.